introduce the topic of the day, which is the Star of Bethlehem. And the general consensus is that, as the astronomer, I can't remember Mark's last name, on the radio show on Thursday, Christine did an interview, and the astronomer was talking that there's kind of three general ideas. Was it a myth? Was it an actual astronomical, like a nova? Or was it some other kind of configuration that was important to those who cared about the astronomy of the time, which were the astrologers? So Christine is basically saying it wasn't the astronomical phenomena. It's not a myth. It's the astronomy, but astronomy as related to meaning that the astrologers or the magi of the time were interested in. So it's actually a much more complex type of question than you might think from just, oh yeah, Star of Bethlehem. It must have just been, you know, we've got a couple of stories and that's it. It's actually much more interesting and fascinating. So thank you, Christine, so much for doing this webinar for us. I'm really looking forward to your talk.
Well, thank you for having me. And this afternoon, this evening, this morning, wherever you may be listening to this, we are going to be looking at quite a few different things. Here is a list of questions, and these are all directly or indirectly related to the star. And we are going to address these questions. What is absolutely phenomenal is that astrology has an answer for all of them. And that was, once I got into the study, that was what literally just blew me away. Okay, let's start with our wise men. Obviously, they were looking at something. Now, they came from very, very different parts of the ancient world. And the only way that we have any identification of them in the Bible is mentioned by the gifts that they brought, which were gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And let me see if I can find the correct link. All right, let's look at where are they coming from. And I've played around with maps like you cannot imagine this week. I'm providing a link here to a map that is available on the internet. Okay, here is an outline of the Middle East. The three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, were representative of three very distinct areas of the ancient world. Now, the first gift that we refer to is gold. In ancient times, there was only one real gold producer in the world, and that was India. Now, as you can see, India is one heck of a long way from where we are interested. The second gift that we have was frankincense. Frankincense is derived from trees that are grown in southern Arabia and Oman. And there you see on the map where Oman is located. The third gift that we are told about was myrrh. Myrrh is derived from trees that grow on either side of the Red Sea, which would be southern Arabia, Yemen, and Ethiopia. And in ancient times, Ethiopia actually straddled the Red Sea and extended its boundaries into southern Arabia. So we're talking three very distinct areas that were separated by a considerable distance. Now, the names of the kings that we were given, we have for the gift of gold, Caspar or Gaspard. For the gift of frankincense, we have Melchior. And for the gift of myrrh, we have Balthazar. And again, these names would tend, if you look into the derivation of the language, they would tend to fit India, Central, Middle East, and potentially Africa. Now, the names were not really connected with the gifts until probably the early Renaissance. So we simply had the gifts, but the gifts themselves were indicative of the locations and the distance that these individuals traveled to get to Jerusalem. Now, you're looking at a very wide area map here. That distance from India, Western India, to Jerusalem would be 1,500, maybe 2,000 miles. This was an incredibly long journey. Even from Oman and Ethiopia, you're still talking 1,000 miles. Again, these were long journeys. In ancient times, the best way to travel would be by boat. But given you go a certain distance by boat, you're still going to have to get off that boat and travel overland. And traveling overland would mean that you needed to get yourself a camel caravan, because you're talking about crossing deserts and mountain ranges. This is not easy terrain. Furthermore, you would want to travel in a group for safety and protection, because even back then, there were bandits out there that were willing to, you know, hold you up in the high road and say, you know, your money or your life. So you traveled with a group. And camel caravans, there were certain hubs that were used to be able to start and end a caravan. And they would travel preset routes, because camels could only go on average 10 to 25 miles per day. Okay, 10 to 25 miles per day, and you're talking a distance of hundreds of miles. Obviously, all of the Magi needed to start well in advance to arrive at their destination. What is remarkable, however, is that even though they were coming from very different areas of the ancient world, they all showed up at the same place at the same time. Something was saying, you know, this is where you need to be, and this is when you need to be there. So they had a goal, a date, a deadline in order to make this journey, in order to be able to arrive in time for the event. Okay, now if we take another look here, let's see if I can find it. Okay. I am going to be paying particular attention to the city of Petra, which is located there in southern Jordan. Petra is about 150 miles from Jerusalem. So we're talking at least a week's journey from Petra to Jerusalem. And you did have that as a major caravan crossing point. Now, Petra is a very interesting city. Let me go back over here. Because it was, in the early Christian era, literally a hub in the middle of the desert. It was a far outpost for the Roman legion. It was a major caravan crossing point. But what was so remarkable about this city is it was literally built into the side of cliffs. And there is only one way in and out. And I'll show you the picture. There's your picture. Let me magnify this a little bit. And it's only accessible single file. It was a safe city in the middle of the desert. And because of the Roman influence, the Romans brought in aqueducts, water. They had a rule of law, there was protection, there was safety, and it was, in ancient times, a major hub. In 300 to 500, there were a series of earthquakes, and the city was eventually abandoned and was not only not discovered until more recent times. But it was a major metropolitan center. And on the right here, you can see a picture of what is the theater. They actually had a Roman amphitheater that was built into the city. So it was a cultural center as well as a safe haven in the desert. Remarkable place. It was also a major caravan crossroads. Now let me see if I can find my... All right, here is your potential for locations. From Kuwait, you could potentially have our visitor from India traveling from there, or you could actually have them coming up through the Red Sea to Aqaba and then traveling overland to Petra. And considering it would take about another week of overland travel, they could then get to Jerusalem. Now, caravans were hired. Ordinarily, a camel caravan would take 18 camels, and they would be in three groups of six camels each. Wealthy people could purchase a ride. Otherwise, it was just like a truck. You could put all kinds of cargo on the back of a camel, which you could then transport from one city to another. But if our visitors all arrived in Petra with the expectation of, well, it'll take us a week to get from here to Jerusalem, we'll hire a caravan, and lo and behold, they probably all ended up in the same caravan. So it is very possible our Magi coming from various different locations would all end up in the same city a little ahead of time, because remember, their deadline date was a specific astronomical event they were anticipating. Now, the question is, what were they anticipating? And the story here is really kind of interesting, because back in 1983, I joined Mensa. Yeah, I'm an egghead. My mother was an astrologer. Her name was Gladys Hall. She was on the board of directors of the American Federation of Astrologers back in the 1980s. Well, when I joined Mensa, it was sort of like, well, if you're so smart, you figure out what was the Star of Bethlehem. It was sort of like, haha, I'm giving you an impossible assignment. And I thought to myself, how extraordinary. 2,000 years and nobody has really come up with anything that really answers any questions about what the star was. Now let's go back to our original question. Why did all those wise men go to Jerusalem? And this was really something that intrigued me. And back in 1983, that was when I started to collect information on what I could find about the star. Because over the course of decades, centuries, to millennia, a lot of people have put forward a lot of ideas. My biggest issue with what I was finding was, here are all these astrologers presenting this chart or that chart, but none of them are doing anything more than a psychological analysis of that chart that says, this explains, you know, Jesus as the person that we understand today. None of them went into the astrology, and this was what I found personally really interesting, because astrology, if you're going to use it, proves itself. It works with transits, it works with secondary progressions, and those are the two main things that I work with as a professional consulting astrologer. And I don't use large orbs. As Enid said earlier, I teach math. I want the math to be dead on. I use orbs, yes, but it better be darn close, or else it's like, you know, this is horseshoes. It's close, but it's no cigar. What I actually uncovered over the course of 10 years of studying and doing charts was absolutely amazing. And this is what I am going to present to you today. Okay, I first published my work in 1993 to the Mensa Astrology Group. It was a small group, yes, eggheads, but I did not receive any objections. And in the Mensa Astrology Group at this time were some very well-known astrologers, including Lois Rodden and Zip Dobbins. And no one really said much of anything. Now, this is published under the name of Elverson. It was only a matter of months later that I met and married my husband, Norman. And so today my name is Christine Ahrens, not Christine Elverson. So this was first published in 1993. I then later had it published in Astrology, Your Daily Horoscope, and that was in 1999. And there's where it is, and there my name is officially Christine Ahrens. The original article that was published in Mensa was longer than the one that was published in Astrology, Your Daily Horoscope. And in the 20 years, 15 years, since both of these were published, I have found even more information. But the information I have found has only further supported what I originally identified. Now, question becomes, what did I identify? Okay, let's take a look. Here is the chart that I originally came up with. May 29th, 7 BC, and we have a new moon on the ascendant, exactly, with Jupiter and Saturn high up in the eastern sky. Now, I looked at quite a number of charts, and I'll run through these briefly here. Okay, early in my research, I was given a pamphlet. This is a soft cover pamphlet called The Search for the Christmas Star. It was published in the early 1980s by Neil Nicholson and Maria K. Sims, both very well-known astrologers. And what they did is they put together a collection of various proposed star charts. This was generally the format they ran it in. I am going to officially show these to you so that you also will have an ability to take a look at this. If you get the podcast, download the webinar cast afterwards, you'll be able to actually take a look at these individual charts because they're all over the place. Here is the first chart. Menke was an astronomer. Now, he came up with a couple of charts. We're looking at this one here for April 6th, 6 BC, and he proposed 1:11:27 a.m. All of the charts that were presented in the book by Nicholson and Sims are presented in Eastern European time. So if you do plan to play around with these charts on your own with your own software, make sure you're looking at Eastern European time as opposed to local mean time, because some programs will default because it is a BC date. Okay, so there's one. Let's pull this down. Here's a second chart that the astronomer Menke presented for April 6th at 11 p.m. So we've got another option. But as you can see, you know, there's Jupiter and Saturn. Here the Sun is in Aries. And here is another chart that was presented. This one is for September 15th of 7 BC, 5:44:51. And again, I'm simply showing these to you because I don't know anywhere that you will find a collection of the proposed charts in print today. If you're lucky, you might be able to find a copy of this particular publication, but it is highly doubtful. Okay, another proposed chart. And here's where it starts to get interesting. Kepler was actually one of the first people to seriously suggest that the Star of Bethlehem might actually have been a conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn. Now this, the chart presented in the Nicholson-Sims book gives a time of 2:45 a.m. However, if you look at this Jupiter-Saturn conjunction, you see there is also Mars involved here. So what you had was a blending of the light of three planetary positions. And if I remember correctly, Kepler actually made a comment about the fact that these three together were so bright you could actually see them in daylight, which is really extraordinary. Okay, there is what Kepler proposed. Now we're going to take a look at the three Jupiter-Saturn conjunctions. The first occurred on May 29th of 7 BC. And there's Jupiter and Saturn in the western sky, exactly conjunct at 20 degrees of Pisces. Now, we're going to come back to this chart. But for right now, we're just taking a look at what was out there. What were people thinking about? What were people looking at? Okay. In 7 BC, there was a triple conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn. This occurs in the sign of Pisces only once every 900 years. So a triple conjunction in Pisces was extraordinary. Jupiter was considered the planet of the Zoroastrians. Saturn was considered the planet of the Jews. So for these two to come together would be, to the Magi, a very significant event. And it was occurring not once, but three times in 7 BC. Okay, there is the first conjunction on May 29th. We'll close this out and we'll pull up the second conjunction. And here is the second conjunction, which occurred on October 1st. And there is Jupiter and Saturn conjunct at 17 degrees of Pisces. And again, the time here is, this is 7:47 in the evening. And then there was a third Jupiter-Saturn conjunction that occurred on December the 5th. And there are Jupiter and Saturn conjunct at 15 degrees of Pisces. So we had three conjunctions of Jupiter and Saturn. All right, now, the next chart we're going to look at is one that has probably received, I would say, the most mileage. Moby Dick was actually an astrologer back in the middle 1900s who was recognized as a biblical scholar. He looked at March 1st of 7 BC as being the date. And the reason why he was so interested in this was the fact that you had such an incredible pileup of planets occurring in the sign of Pisces. Basically, this was a pileup that you would see once in 1,000 years. And so for him, this was the chart. And he actually wrote a book called Astrology's Pew in the Church, in which he goes into great length to discuss, you know, in words, why this chart is correct. What he doesn't get into is the astrology of why the chart is correct. So even though this is one that probably has seen more recognition, it doesn't really give you all the answers. And what we're going to do is we're going to answer all those questions that we had at the beginning. Okay. Next chart. This was a channeled chart. Now, you know, I'm all for people who are highly sensitive and very tuned in with ESP, but I'm sorry, it just, that to me is not astrology. So again, this was another chart that was put forward as a potential for the birth of Christ, August 21st at midnight. Now let's open up. Now here is Zip Dobbins' proposed chart. But she herself says, very honestly, this is a speculative chart. And she looks to that the second of the Jupiter-Saturn conjunctions in 7 BC as being the date. And again, you know, we have a potential here. She put the Jupiter-Saturn conjunction up at the top of the chart as her proposal for what the birth of Christ would be. Now, to accompany this, she went forward. She is probably the only one who actually did, because based on that chart, she then determined what would be the date of the crucifixion, which she calls April 3rd, 33 BC. Now, this would put Christ, if he was born in 7 BC with the second of the Jupiter-Saturn conjunctions, this would put Christ at age 40, which, again, does not fit with the scripture as what we have had handed down to us over 2,000 years. So, and she herself, like I said, this is totally speculative. All right, then we get into Mark Penfield, another potential chart. And again, we're looking at September of 7 BC. 7 BC seems to be astrologically the year that we're tuning into. But we have different dates, different times being presented as potentially the chart for the Christ child. All right, now let's go to what does the Talmud say? And again, here we are, April 12th of 7 BC. And this is a Jewish tradition. We have Jupiter and Saturn close, not conjunct. But this is what has been handed down through that particular set of information. April 12th, 1:51 a.m. And then over here, we have Addie's presentation. Addie, of course, was a brilliant astrological mathematician. He too looks at 7 BC, but he's looking at August. There is his chart, August 22nd, 7:48 p.m. And I believe there is another one. Let me go down here. Yes. Ruth Hale Oliver, who was a very well-known astrologer in probably the 1940s through the 1960s. She too is looking at 7 BC. So 7 BC seems to be a pretty hot year as far as the astrology is concerned. So she came up with October 8th at 5:35 p.m. All right, now that being said, we need to take another look. There we go, let's try that. There we are.
There they are.
Okay. Okay, now the chart that I was looking at, let's see if I can pull that one up. All right. What I was looking at was May 29th of 7 BC. This was the first of three Jupiter-Saturn conjunctions, as I said. What was unique about this day was the fact that you had two astronomical cycles, natural cycles, occurring on the same day. Now, under ordinary circumstances, the likelihood of this was not real high. So this was something that would get attention. If the Magi were looking for a place on Earth to go, the location would be with the new moon on the ascendant. Now, I looked at this particular day because it was one of those days that we actually were looking at back here. This chart that was presented by Mickelson and Sims did the chart for the exact conjunction of Jupiter and Saturn. But you can see at that point that there was a new moon that day. You've got them up there in the 10th house. I actually found a book that was published in 1989. Let me see if I can find it. That's not it. Where is it? Ah, I can't find it. All right. But it was published by Elizabeth Dietz Gerke, or written by Elizabeth Dietz Gerke, and published by the American Federation of Astrologers in 1989, called, surprisingly, The Star of Bethlehem. And in it, she actually does, see if not there. I wish I could show it to you because it really was absolutely fascinating. Nope, that's not it. Ah, well. But she actually proposed that we should look at the chart for May 29th because it had some interesting things. Now, she did her calculations obviously without a computer. The chart that I came up with, let's see if I can find it. Actually, by computer calculation, puts 4 degrees of Gemini on the ascendant with both the moon and sun at 4 degrees of Gemini. Her calculations came up with 3 degrees of Gemini. But she made a very interesting comment in that this would present some very interesting things to consider if you started to look at the progressed chart and the transits. And she actually did include an ephemeris in her book for 7 BC. She looked not just at this first Jupiter-Saturn conjunction, she also looked at the second and third. However, with the first one, she noted that 12 days following this new moon, Mercury turned retrograde. She also commented that, well, if you're born with a new moon, with secondary progressions at age 30, you would have a progressed new moon. Now, both of those particular pieces of information fit our puzzle. And that's where it starts to get interesting because the astrology does If you consider what we're told in scripture, the wise men actually were not present at the manger. They came to a house. Now, the house would be in Jerusalem. Now, this would be 12 days after the birth. Mercury turns retrograde, and the wise men disappear. They said, "Oh, yeah, we're going to come back and tell you, Herod. We'll let you know where this boy is." And they did not. They simply returned home by their separate ways. Mercury retrograde 12 days following the birth would be a perfect astrological indication of why the wise men did not go back to Herod. Now, let's take a look at what Scripture does tell us, because it does tell us some very interesting things. Let's see if I can get this out. Okay. It came to pass a decree was sent forward that a census of the entire world should be taken. We know when those censuses were taken. And let me see if I can find my reference here on this. And I'll magnify this a bit here and see if I can. Okay. Here is the key portion. The dates of the empire-wide taxes were 28 BC, 8 BC, and 14 AD. Now we're talking a big empire. It is very possible that they would have been given all the outlying areas a nominal amount of time to be able to have people register for their taxes. And of course, we are told, oops, over here, let's find the right one. Joseph went from Galilee out of Nazareth, which was his home, into Judea to Bethlehem to register for his taxes. And I was really kind of annoyed in the radio broadcast that we did Thursday night because the astronomer seemed to just totally tossed this aside. They weren't really Roman citizens and they didn't have to register. But yet the Bible tells us this is exactly what they did do. Now, if the call for taxes were 28 BC, 8 BC, and 14 AD, obviously 28 BC is too early, 14 AD is too late. But that 8 BC tax call now becomes a reference point for us because it would seem that sometime after that decree was made would be the time of the birth. And it would not be a terribly long time, a year maybe at most. Okay, so that takes us to 7 BC and that triple Jupiter-Saturn conjunction. All right, we have two stories of the birth of Christ. We have the story which is told in Luke that he was laid in a manger wrapped in swaddling clothes, and then we have the story in Matthew. Let me see if I can find Matthew. And in Matthew, we are told the Magi actually entered his house. So these are two very distinct issues. Here's where it starts to get kind of intriguing, piecing together what happened during this 12 days. All right, the child was born May 29th. For 7 days following the birth, a mother is considered unclean and is not really supposed to interact with other people. Okay, so Joseph and Mary stay in Bethlehem for 7 days. On the eighth day, this is when the child needs to be brought for his circumcision. Let's see, where do I have it? Who talks about that? Not Matthew, must be Luke. Ah, here we go. When 8 days were fulfilled for his circumcision, his name was called Jesus. So he was taken to the rabbis on the eighth day. The rabbis would have immediately known who this child was. And why would that be? Because Herod was searching all over the place trying to find this child. Let's go over here to Matthew. The Magi show up on May 29th. They've come from very far distant worlds. They've traveled literally hundreds, maybe thousands of miles to get there. But they're all arriving on the same day at the same time. And they're all going to the king and saying, congratulations, you're a dad. Where's the baby? And of course, Herod had no child, so it was quite a surprise to him. So what is he going to do? He's going to start looking for a newborn baby. And my guess personally is he actually had people going door to door in Jerusalem, because we are told all Jerusalem was troubled. Herod was troubled, and so was all Jerusalem. So everybody was aware something was going on. When Joseph and Mary brought Christ in for his circumcision, the rabbis would know, and they would simply say, you need to get the heck out of town as quick as possible, because if you are identified, there may be trouble. I mean, here is a potential rival to Herod. Herod was no sweet guy. He killed his wife. He killed one of his children. And given a potential rival, an infant, easy to eliminate. So here we are on the eighth day. Mary and Joseph maybe would have wanted to stay in Jerusalem overnight, but no, they really needed to move quickly. And where did they go? They went to back to their home in Nazareth. Okay, so let's take a look at, let's find the right page here, go back here to our maps. Let's zoom in. Okay, there is Jerusalem. And Nazareth is quite a good distance, oopsie, north. There is Nazareth, almost due north of Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is, okay, let's see if I can figure out how to work this. Okay, there is Nazareth, and Jerusalem is about 100 miles south of Nazareth. And Bethlehem is just south of Jerusalem. So let's see if I can, at any rate, okay. But that gives you a good idea. So here they are traveling. Let's see if I can find my maps here. All right, Nazareth. And then we have Jerusalem and Bethlehem, and they are almost all on the same meridian of longitude. What is unique is that at this degree of longitude on the surface of the Earth, that new moon conjunction would be exactly on the eastern horizon. And that was why all these wise men came to Jerusalem. There was one city, one capital city of the ancient world, where this new moon would be on the horizon exactly on the day of the conjunction. Now, what is interesting is when you look at the declinations, the moon and sun are both very high in the sky. They would actually be rising side by side. Really an absolutely spectacular visual type of observation. And if you look, Jupiter and Saturn are within 1 degree of declination as well. So they are very close together. And again, their light blending, they would appear as a single large star in the eastern sky. So yes, the Magi saw the star in the east. And for all of them, no matter what location on Earth, that star would be rising in the east. And the more modern translations of the Bible actually refer to it as a star rising in the east, not necessarily just a star in the east. But the location on Earth would have to be on that meridian of longitude, and the only capital city was Jerusalem. So here you are, you have a sunrise, new moon, birth. Now, the horizon represents where the sky and the earth meet. The sun rules the day, the moon rules the night, and here they are both together right at the edge of the horizon. You've got the power of the heavens coming to the earth. This was an incredibly potent astrological configuration. Now, I came up with this 20 years ago. Just this year, there was something that was forwarded to me that I was absolutely just stupefied by. And this was something that Bernadette Brady published from the University of Wales. And we're going to come down here to page 447. And I'll magnify this so that you can see it a little better. Okay. On this page, she talks about having sunrise charts. And here is where it gets really interesting, right in here. Let's see if I can pull this over a bit so that you can read all of it. Okay. The sun was associated with sustained imperial power. The Roman Emperor Augustus and the Emperor Nero both considered themselves divine because they were born at sunrise. So here we are. I came up with this sunrise chart 20 years ago. But yes, this would be astrologically to the ancients an indicator of divinity. Now, in the radio broadcast I did on Thursday, the astronomer that I was interviewed with actually added to this, and I don't think he realized it. He was actually supporting what I was saying, because he said there are records that say that Magi traveled from the east to Nero in Rome to pay homage to him, and there are written records to this day. So here we have Magi making two known trips, both to recognize individuals with sunrise births. So this actually became something that I was like, oh, wow, that's something else that fits right in with everything. Okay, so here we are. We've got our official time of birth, not this chart, but this chart, which would be with the new moon on the ascendant. Now, what does this do? Well, we talked about the fact that Mercury turned retrograde 12 days after. The child Jesus was identified in Jerusalem by the rabbis at the time of his circumcision. The rabbi said, Joseph, Mary, you need to go now. So they returned to Nazareth. And as you saw from the map, Nazareth was not a short distance. It was a journey of several days. So it would take them at least 3 days to get from Jerusalem to Nazareth. Now, you're talking, how far can you travel in a day? You're talking on foot. One of the things that I actually researched was how fast do camels travel? How fast do donkeys travel? And you're talking, on average, 10 to 25 miles a day. So we're talking a trip of 75, 80, maybe 100 miles. If they were really trying to hustle and make the trip as quickly as they could to get back, then they would have definitely arrived in Jerusalem somewhere around the 11th or 12th day. And of course, the Magi were tipped off by the rabbis who said, hey, this is the child. This is where he lives. We told them to get out of town as quickly as possible. If you want to give him honor, this is where you need to go. So here's Joseph and Mary. They've got a little bit of a head start. But the Magi are right behind them. And yes, the Magi, the story of the Magi presenting the gifts in his home would be appropriate, and it would fit that 12th day, which also gives us our 12 days of Christmas. And in many countries, Christmas, the December 25th celebration, is the religious holiday. But the secular holiday, when everybody parties and exchanges gifts, is held on January 6th, the 12th day of Christmas. So, again, we've got a scenario that fits. He was born in Bethlehem, had his circumcision in Jerusalem, and then returned home to Nazareth. And there's the Magi with their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. All right, let's go back to our original questions. See if I can find them. There we are. Okay. So we've answered now, why did they all go to Jerusalem? Why did they return home without reporting to Herod? Why do we have 12 days of Christmas? Why do we have two stories about the birth? Now, why did Herod slaughter boy babies age 2 and under? And here we are again to Saturn. Saturn was the planet that represented the Jews. Now, we're told in Scripture that the Magi explained to Herod they saw the star in the east, and that was the reason they were there. But we're also told that Herod called them aside. Let's see, I think that was, that would be Matthew. Herod summoned the Magi secretly to carefully determine from them when the star appeared. So, I mean, this was part of their religion. They're not about to tell Herod exactly how their religion works and how they understand all these wonderful things that the sky tells them. I am sure they were very vague, and they said, well, you know, Saturn is the planet that represents the Jews. We determined that from the planet Saturn. Saturn went into Pisces approximately 2 years earlier. Remember, in the proposed chart that we are looking at, we have Saturn and Jupiter at 20 Pisces. They're relatively well through the sign. So they tell Herod, okay, we saw Saturn go into Pisces 2 years ago. Herod's going to make absolutely sure no child with Saturn in Pisces is going to survive. And that was the reason we had the slaughter of the innocents. He was going to make sure he eliminated any potential conflict. Okay, now we get into the really interesting stuff. What was significant at the age of 12? Well, we've already said on the 12th day following that May 29th birth, Mercury turned retrograde. At the age of 12, a Jewish boy would make his bar mitzvah. He would be questioned by his teachers, but what we're told is that he was actually questioning them as well. And Joseph and Mary were already a day's journey on their way back to Nazareth before they realized Jesus was not in the caravan with them. So they turned around and went back to Jerusalem to find him. A stationary Mercury. Mercury is your planet of communication and teaching. Here was the child Jesus teaching the teachers. The brilliant and the power of a stationary Mercury. However, you also had a boy who was respectful of his parents and their wishes. And so he returned to Nazareth with them, and he entered his private life. And then we don't hear anything about the child until he enters public life at age 30. Well, in a secondary progressed chart, if the child is born with the new moon at age 30, he will have a progressed new moon, which would indicate a new beginning and a new direction in life. So we now have identified an astrological reason for the birth and why the wise men showed up in Jerusalem and the whole timeline of what happened at that time. We have an astrological explanation for his teaching in the temple. We have an astrological explanation for his entry into public life at age 30. Now we get to the real singer of all of this, which is the chart for the crucifixion. And I will personally say, I played around with this chart for May 29th quite a bit. I looked at putting the Jupiter-Saturn conjunction on the midheaven. I looked at putting it on the ascendant. I looked at the actual exact Jupiter-Saturn conjunction. I looked at putting the new moon on the midheaven. I looked at putting the new moon on the ascendant. It was all of this. And so I played around with quite a few charts before I really, really tuned in that this is the chart. And when I did the secondary progressions for the crucifixion, I literally almost fell on the floor. I was absolutely stupefied. The math was right on, down to a minute. I was just with my mouth open. And here's where we're going to start to look at what we've got. Let's pull this up. That's not going to do it. File open. Okay. I hear somebody clicking away on a typewriter.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was actually thought I was still muted to answer a question. There was a comment that while you're getting that bar mitzvah is usually at 13, not 12, but from everything I know, it can be either age 12 or 13, at least according to my Jewish friends.
Well, we're looking pretty close here.
Yeah. But the other part of that comment that's interesting is Uranus Jupiter synod at age 12. So that's another, and that the 40 days and 40 nights for could also support a 7 BC dates for the 40 years of, well, hold it, let me ask Sonia, what 40 days and 40 nights for the 40 years of Joss's life? I'm not quite sure. If she is,
let's see.
Oh,
sorry.
Yeshua. Okay.
All right. Here is a bi-wheel for the transits. The actual date of death would, let's see. Okay. March 29th, 28 AD. Let's look at the transits first because that's one piece. All right. If we look only at the inner planets that the ancients would have used, there is nothing extraordinary or spectacular. However, when we get to looking at the outer bi-wheel, here is something that is rather interesting. We have our Sun Moon Ascendant at 4 degrees of Gemini, and there is Pluto sitting at 4 degrees of Sagittarius within 1 minute. And you've got to remember, this is not only opposing the Sun and Moon, it's also opposing the Ascendant, which is the physical body. So there's a zinger of a transit exactly at the time of the crucifixion. But here is what literally blew me away. Let me open secondary progression. Let me do this one. Even just working with the inner positions, you are absolutely amazed. Here we have a progressed midheaven right on that natal Jupiter-Saturn conjunction. And here's the midheaven first conjuncting Jupiter, and Jupiter is ruler of the eighth house, which is death. Now the other interesting piece comes down here when we look at the progressed ascendant and sun, both conjunction Venus. Venus is ruler of the sixth house cusp and co-ruler of the 12th. And the progressed sun is exact to the minute. These mathematical calculations are so exact. I literally was blown away. It was like, holy cow, there's no question in my mind, with this kind of progressions, this has to be the correct chart. Okay. Now, I am going to make a statement here, and this has to do with astrological software. I teach math, astrological math. Everything in the astrological math works from sidereal time. However, what has become very popular in the last 20 years is to do your angular progressions by solar arc. And quite frankly, in my opinion, when you start mixing arcs with natural movement, you're mixing apples and oranges. If you want to replicate this, and I have done this with several different programs, so I know the math here is right on. You need to make sure your computer is calculating in right ascension. And as you can see in the upper right, it says secondary progression, NABOD NRA. Usually the default setting for computers today is solar arc. And in my opinion, that is not correct. It will not come out the same. But if you choose to actually go and look at these charts on your own with your own software, you should be able to replicate all of this, which is remarkable. So I have pretty much shown you all of what there is to see. Let's go back to our list of questions. We've answered everything here except number 9, the virgin birth. And this is a matter of faith for many Christians. However, consider if he was born with the sun in the early degrees of Gemini, it is very likely he was conceived at the time the sun was in the sign of Virgo, the Virgin. Hello. Okay, I think we've covered absolutely every possible question revolving around the traditions, the history, the myth, the reality, but most particularly the astrology. And what is really astounding is astrology answers all of these questions. So there I am. I've given you a piece of my mind. I don't know that I can spare it, but for what it is worth, it is something to give you to think about and play with. Enjoy.
Well, thank you, Christine. This is this is me thinking of, okay, now I got to get my hands on my software.
Well, this is why I showed you all of the various proposed charts. Because as I said, I don't know where you would be able to find a collection like this anywhere else. Astronomers, of course, are looking for something that's visually big stuff. They want a nova. They want, they talk about the great conjunctions in 3 and 2 BC with Jupiter and Venus and Regulus. But these don't have the astrological mechanisms to support the story. Furthermore, 3 and 2 BC are a heck of a long way away from when that tax call was made. So if you're going to follow what the scripture says, you have some very specific information to work with.
Definitely. And to find something that matches all those different pieces is pretty impressive.
Well, that was what I found so amazing. because the astrology does answer all of it. Okay.
Well, we'll have to put some of this into a package that we'll send along with the recording for everybody, so that you'll have some a handout to go along with. There's quite a few, wow, zinger at the end. Are there any specific questions? Looks like you got all their questions all the way along, Christine.
Well, you know, in the course of 30 years, I've had a lot of time to think about this.
And probably had a lot of questions already.
I have. Again, as I said, the more I have found, the more that supports what I came up with 20 years ago.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, and thank you, everyone. I'm, as you know, do some editing so that we can have a nice, clean recording for you. I'm going to try to get this one out the door as quickly as possible. And thank you so much for Christine for doing this, and thank you, everyone, for joining, and the students who will get a scholarship will thank you as well.
Oh, yes.
And what comes next in our webinars?
What comes next is the January 18 one. I already mentioned, but I'll bring that back up again. Let's see. It's January 18 is Patricia Waltz on Generations, looking at Pluto cycles. So that one's free. And thank you, everybody. I hope you have a fabulous rest of your afternoon and a wonderful holiday, whether you celebrate. Somebody's commenting, yes, with Hera dying by 4 BCE, the 2 yes. BCE date doesn't work so well.
No, it doesn't.
Have put forth, does it? So.
And that was one piece that I did forget to include. We have a date of death for Herod as being sometime when a lunar eclipse was visible in Jerusalem. And most historians believe that this eclipse took place on March 13th, 4 BC. So the birth would most likely be between 4 BC and 8 BC. So it narrows it down a little bit.
And then using progressions and a little bit of astrological, well, actually more than just a little bit of astrological knowledge, we get a very intriguing date.
Indeed.
And that last chart is pretty impressive. Well, have a wonderful holiday season, everyone. Happy celebrating of whatever celebration you do. And the return of the light is approaching in, what do we have? If we're the 14th, it's the 22nd, I believe, this year that we have our solstice. So I hope everybody enjoys the solstice. And I guess that's it for today. So thank you again.